In this problem, we have a spring and mass system sliding back and forth on a smooth surface. In other words, it has negligible friction. And this is all done in general terms. So the spring constant is K, and the original mass for the simple harmonic oscillator is big M. The complication here is that we stacked another mass on top of big M, and that's going to experience a static friction force in the interaction with the big M that it's sitting on top of. And what we're trying to find is the maximum amplitude of oscillation before that little mass breaks loose. So in the picture, we're already looking at the relevant location for the analysis of this problem. So when X is equal to the amplitude of this harmonic oscillator, that's where we're going to experience our maximum spring force, because that's the maximum displacement of the spring. Therefore, that's where we experience the maximum acceleration of the system, and therefore it's the location where we're most likely to break the mass loose. So the strategy here is that we assume that the little mass M does not break loose, but at some point during the calculation, we have to put into the mathematics that the static friction force is at its maximum possible value. And remember, that's just given by mu s times the normal force. So the first thing I'm going to do here is try to get a handle on the acceleration of the system at this location. And remember, little m is not slipping, so the spring is responsible for accelerating m plus m. So this is one way to visualize it. We're just visualizing big M plus little m as a single mass. So we surrounded them with a dotted line, and our spring is exerting a force to the left on them, and the magnitude of that is given by Hooke's law as k times x. So now we can just write down Newton's second law applied to the combination of the two masses. So for little m plus big M, Newton's second law says F net equals ma, and the net force on them is kx, given by Hooke's law. The total mass that we're accelerating is little m plus big M, and we're going to solve for a. So with our x location being equal to the maximum amplitude, I can write the left-hand side as k times a max, and we're going to divide by the sum of the two masses, and we find our acceleration. That's going to be k times a max divided by the sum of the two masses. All right, so there's the acceleration in terms of this max amplitude that we're interested in finding. Now we need to switch to a force analysis on the little mass that sits on top of our big block. All right, so there's three forces acting on this guy. We know that it's accelerating to the left, and the force responsible for doing that is the static friction force, pulling it to the left through that surface interaction at the interface between the two blocks. And then for the vertical forces here, we just have gravity pulling down on little m with a magnitude of little mg. And there's nothing else tampering with the vertical direction, so the normal force is simply equal to little mg. And again, that static friction force must be the thing responsible for the observed acceleration of that little mass m. So we're going to do a Newton's second law analysis on the little block now. So we're thinking F net equals ma in the horizontal direction. And the net force there is Fs. The mass of the block is little m, and our acceleration is little a. So we can put in the details on the static friction force. Remember, we needed to get into the equations here the fact that the static friction force is maxed out. And we have a simple formula for that. When the static friction force is maxed out, it's equal to mu s times the normal force, or mu s mg. On the right-hand side, we have our little m times the acceleration that we calculated in terms of a max. So ka max over the sum of the two masses. And the m's cancel out. And what we're trying to do is solve for a max. So we multiply both sides by m plus m, and we divide by k, and we find a maximum amplitude equal to mu s times g times the sum of the two masses divided by the spring constant k. Now for a general solution like this, we're always trying to find ways to check the reasonableness of our answer. One way to do that is to look at the units here. So an amplitude should have units of meters. On the right-hand side, the coefficient of static friction is unitless, but we have then a term with acceleration, that's g, which we measured in meters per second squared. We have a term with mass, that's measured in kilograms. And then in our denominator, we have a spring constant, which is measured in newtons per meter. Now remember from Newton's second law, F equals ma, the units of force, in other words, newtons, are equal to the units of mass times the units of acceleration. And that's exactly what I see up here in this numerator. That's just a newton, a kilogram meter per second squared. So now our newtons are going to cancel, and I have 1 divided by 1 divided by meters. In other words, just meters coming out of this the way it was supposed to.
If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.